When all things that surround Let's go ahead and offer up a word of prayer over the offering this morning. Father God, we just thank you that we can come before you and bring forward this offering out of our lives. And we ask that you would bless and multiply it around our community and around our world with the message of salvation through faith in your risen Son, Jesus of Nazareth. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So, good morning, all. Cheery chirp row. You're all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, right? Maybe a touch more so than some of us, not naming names or pointing fingers. Anyways, do we have any big announcements for this fun upcoming week with all the extra time that we're saving? All the daylight time. Wow, it's going to be a... Seder dinner Thursday, March 28th. This is celebrating the Passover in the Christian faith, basically. And explaining kind of what that is. So, Seder dinner Thursday, March 28th. 6 o'clock here at Living Word Community Church. Please join us. Bring family, friends. So any and all help for making said Seder meal, greatly graciously appreciated by Pastorette Jean. And so please talk with Jean Hines and touch base with her to help out and enjoy the Seder meal and celebrate the Passover. Yep. What was their last name again?
Larson.
Larson's?
Okay.
Yes, well, we will keep them in thoughts and prayers, and we'll lift them up in the prayer request time and adventure on into a journey of learning and growth in our faith and our walk with our Heavenly Father, right, friends? Since everybody's also cheery and chipper and everything, yeah. Let's go ahead and open up with a word of prayer to start our time this morning. Father God, I just thank you that we can gather together as your children through our faith in Jesus of Nazareth as our Lord and Savior. And Father, I just ask for your Holy Spirit to speak your gospel and your good news through my lips to our open ears and hearts this morning, and help us to live out your message of love to all those around us through this season that is known and called of Lent as we prepare to celebrate the resurrection, the sacrifice and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you for speaking your words through my lips, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. So, second, third, fourth, eighth time, whatever. Morning, all. Cheers. Good to see all of your smiling faces this morning. And a big, giant thank you to Pastor Bill for delivering the great message of empowering the youth in our lives with God's love and his truth for them last week. Thank you very much, Dad, a.k.a. Pastor Bill. And also great dedication for little Harper Hicks. She starts her journey and walk into coming to know who Jesus is for her. And that begs the question of who is Jesus and who is God for each one of us? How do I view Jesus? How do I view him? How do I have a relationship with God? Is he truly my Heavenly Father? How am I listening to him today? In Deuteronomy, we'll drift back in the Old Testament to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 18. When the Israelites were encouraged by Moses, by God through Moses, do what is right and good in the Lord's sight, so all will go well with you. Then you will enter and occupy the good land that the Lord swore to give your ancestors. I like how this is kind of a two-part verse here, where it's like, slot A, okay, this is the objective, and then slot B, here's the outcome. I like the objectives and outcomes idea. And to the reminder to, if we do what is right and good in the Lord's sight, all will go well with you. And what happens when all goes well with us? We get to enter and occupy the good land that the Lord swore to give our ancestors. And also thinking about remembering the fact that as we're doing good, what is right and good in the Lord's sight, there's lots of little eyes, young eyes. They might be biologically young. They might be spiritually young. They might be young at heart. However young they are, there's young eyes watching each and every one of us. They're watching me and they're watching you as we choose to do what is right and what is good in the Lord's sight. And giving them the example to learn how to enter the land of faith that they hear about. Because what is the good land available to each and every one of us in here today? The land of faith and the land of hope that God's word promises us. And that our Christian faith and studying the history of the Christian faith has passed down to us. There's a lot of good and a lot of hope. Is there times of struggle? Yes, there have been times of struggle. And there might be times of struggle for each one of us at different times. But we can have that faith and that hope that we can charge on into anything, knowing that, all right, God is there with me, and he's going to go into and enter the land with me. It's not like we have to go in and enter this land of faith by ourselves. He's there with a hand out saying, come with me, brothers, sisters, children. In Psalms 119, verse 9, encourages, for how can a young person stay pure? By obeying your word. So again, all young people, biologically young, spiritually young, you know, emotionally, whatever the youth, young at heart, whatever the young and youth that we have around us and in us, how can we stay pure? By obeying God's word. And the fact that I saw this little bunny trail here real quick, rabbit running around a tree, but I saw something on one of the social media pages the other day, and it had this picture of the cartoon characters, the two guys, and there's a guardrail fence up, and it says God's word, or God's truth, God's laws, is what the fence is labeled, and the one character is jumping over, I don't like feeling restrained and pushed back and held back, and he's jumping over this fence. And the buddy that's standing right there saying, no, wait, it's not a fence, it's a guardrail. Because there's nothing but a sheer cliff off of the other side. And so if I can remember that when I choose to go against God's suggestive truths for me here, to love him with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love my neighbor as I love myself, when I drift away from those truths, there might be a really hard, sharp drop on the other side of the guardrail that I'm jumping over. So that begs the question then, what is the example that I present to each person, myself included, in my life with the importance of my Heavenly Father's word to me? How am I displaying to the world around me, especially the one looking back at me in the mirror, myself, how important his word, his written word, and also his spoken word, that time spent in some prayer, some thoughtful meditation, saying, okay, God, everything is shut off. I'm ready to hear. What do you have to say to me? What can you tell me right now about my situation and this? What's going on, God? So what am I living out as an example of that? And another thought, thinking about by obeying his word, He has blessings for those who prioritize his word. We have the promises in his word of the blessings for those who will prioritize it. In James 1, verse 25, tells us, "But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it." So will I take that time? Because do you have a list? Do you have a list? And we better add 3 more dash marks at the bottom, right? Because we got to get this accomplished and this and this and this accomplished today before next week. Got to get it done before the 17th. Whatever the scenario might be. Are all those, am I taking time to shut all of those off? And God, this time right now is ours. I want to spend this time with you in your word and in prayer and hear from you right now, Father. What would you have me do? What would you have me think about this situation that my family's in, the situation that I'm in as an individual, the work that I do, the relationship, this relationship that I'm praying for, whatever the scenarios that we're talking to God about might be. Taking time to shut off all the checklist and say, okay, God, there is not a checklist here with you. What is it that you want to talk about right now? Because I trust that as I learn about his will and his priorities from his word, when I take time to spend time with him in his word and study Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and all of the epistles, and all of the joy in the Psalms and the Proverbs, and the Old Testaments that tell me about who Jesus will be, and everything leading up to him, I can learn about God's will and his priorities, and the Holy Spirit can help direct me to his will through the scriptures that I read, and then the thoughts that I have about those scriptures. So one thing I appreciate is being blessed with a lot of windshield time, as everyone who's ever worked with Old West Ultrasound knows about. there's an abundance of time beside bovines and the lessons that we get to learn beside great four-legged creatures, right? But there's also an excessive abundance of, yep, another tree, cool. Fence lines look good over here. Didn't have too much of a hard winter in that draw. That's good. You know, just consistent windshield time blesses us with a lot of time to sit there and think and meditate and ponder on, oh yes, John 14:6, John 3:16. So how has God so loved me today that I may enter everlasting life? How can I share that with others? All those different points that we can ponder on. In Psalms 37, verse 24, gives us the encouragement that the Lord directs the steps of the godly. He delights in every detail of their lives. Now stop. How big is that? That's how important you are to Yahweh, God, the creator of everything, the one who created and scattered all the stars out in the sky and created everything with the word that he spoke. You are important enough that he delights in every detail of your life. He delights in every detail of my life. That's how important we are to our Heavenly Father. So have I made him that important? Have I made him important in my life? Am I making him important in my daily thoughts, my words, the actions, and the way that I live out my life? Am I making him important since we're in this season of preparing for our Lord and Savior's walk into Jerusalem, celebrate the Passover and the sacrifice of himself that he gave for each and every one of us, followed by his glorious resurrection? What are the details for my life and your life that we're living out in preparing for that time? In John 14, verses 15 to 16, yeah, sorry. Anyways, I'll read from this side and you can kind of, "If you love me, obey me. Obey my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit who leads into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. But you know him because he lives with you now and will later be in you. So we have the promise that God's Holy Spirit will dwell with us and lead and guide us. So is my heart and my mind and what I'm thinking on, is it in line with what the Holy Spirit would like to think about and would like to ponder on, would like to lead me with? Or, wait a second, I got to get through my checklist. Holy Spirit, hold on just 1 second. I got 4 more dash marks to check off on my checklist here real quick. Have I gotten into that mode? The busy, 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 busy mode. We'll talk about busyness more towards the end. But busy seems to be a heavy theme at some times of year and at different seasons in our lives. But with the faith that can come through the humility of repentance from self-centered living, by seeking Jesus to be both my Savior and my Lord, I can start and continue to move any and all of the mountains that may try to stand in the way of my usefulness to God as my Heavenly Father, and my usefulness to all of my fellow man, each and every person that I want to be a positive, uplifting witness to about the fact that God loves you. I know God loves you, each and every one of you. How do I know that? Because I can look in the mirror and say the same thing. God loves you because of the truth that he has shown me and that he's shown all of us through his word and through the examples in our history. So we have the opportunity to move the mountains that may try to stand in the way of our usefulness. And that being able to move a mountain with our faith, that little mustard seed of faith, right? A little mustard seed of faith tucked in the back pocket, small enough you can't even see it. But that mustard seed enables us to live out and accomplish Colossians 3, verse 23. Work willingly at whatever you do, as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. Now, is this the funnest verse to meditate and ponder on? Sometimes. Sometimes not so much. As you're sitting there, I can remember several different springs ago when the snow was fairly a whole lot deeper than it was this spring. And I was in the springtime occupation of helping out at the ranch and fixing fence. And on about the second or third or fifth or eighth draw, whatever it was, and it's the same, the fence wires are, and the posts are, and I mean, it's like, oh, wow. Okay, what are we going to do here? Remanufacture the whole new fence, you know? And it's easy in moments like that, and it's not just with fencing, but with anything that we do in life, that I've done in life. It's easy to get in the go, go, go checklist, got to get as many things done as I possibly can, right? And get in a hurry and a hustle. Oh, this is good enough. Has anyone ever had the good enough argument in their mind? I'll confess that, yes, I've had the good enough. It's, oh, yeah, this is good enough. It'll work for now. It'll work fine for now. It'll be okay. We can fix it right later. I'm very grateful to a good voice of wisdom that said, if I'm going to fix something, I'm going to fix it right and perfect so that it's ready to go and run for me to make business function and work and run. So just realizing that the just good enough, I can cast that aside and say, what is the best that I can do with this project, with this job, with this work? What is the best that I can do with this relationship, with this friendship, with my clients, with my friends? What is the best I can be in my role in that situation? And then how do I do that? Like I'm doing it for the Lord rather than for people. God, how can I be your best friend today? Father God, how can I be your best son, your best daughter? The best, most effective son, the most effective daughter, the most effective witness that I can be to those who will be around me today. Jesus gives us a parable to meditate on in Luke 18, verses 39 to 41. And the parable prior to this, the blind Jesus is walking, doing ministry, walking down the roads and the streets, and there's the blind man who's shouting out profusely and loudly that Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. But Luke 18, 39 to 41, be quiet, the people in front yelled at him, but he only shouted louder, Son of David, have mercy on me. When Jesus heard him, he stopped and ordered that the man be brought to him. As the man came near, Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do for you? Lord, he said, I want to see. And to pregame for the thought that we want to bring up here, I want to talk about a cow chewing a cud. As you're driving around, and if you've ever been working with cattle or driving down the road and seeing cows in pastures, do you ever see cows relaxing, chewing their cud? They're just sitting there, and they're not, you know, they're busy out grazing sometimes, and they're busy doing other things at times. But when a cow is chewing her cud, it looks like one of the most relaxed animals on earth sometimes, most of the time. She's just sitting there. You know, they might take time to look around just a little bit and back up. Slowly chewing that cud. And if I'll take time to remember from my times in meditation to slow down and be as peaceful as that cow chewing her cud and meditating on God's truth that he's revealing to me in my thoughts and he's revealing to me in scripture. Taking time to meditate on what God has said and what I've heard about God. Just like that blind man. Had he ever seen Jesus? Had he seen the works that Jesus did? No, he was blind. The only thing he had was what he could hear. And he heard who Jesus was and what Jesus could do. And so he called out, I'm going to go find this person. Son of David, have mercy on me. I need help. I want help. Will I remember that in my time with God? God, here I am. I want help. I need help. Please help me in this situation, Father. And I can also realize that when it's God's will for me to stop and slow down to love others as I love myself. When I see someone that needs help and is calling out for help, will I follow my Lord and Savior's example and slow down and help them? Bring that person, you know, you don't have to say bring that person to me, but what can I do to help this person who is in need, who needs that little spiritual spark and uplift? One of my favorite ways to help out, as you all know all too well, right? You know, a big smile or a friendly handshake might not seem like the biggest deal in the world for the giver's eyes, but the person receiving it, that might be the highlight of their day, week, month, who knows? And I can follow Peter's example. The Apostle Peter gave us an example of this with the beggar in Acts 3, verse 6. But Peter said, I don't have any silver or gold for you, but I'll give you what I have. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, get up and walk. Peter knew what Jesus' name could do, and he had faith in what Jesus could do. And so that's what he gave people. Will I do the same thing? Will I follow his wisdom and guidance to say, okay, this person is in need. Jesus, how can I use the power that you've blessed me with to positively influence their life and encourage them? And preparing to celebrate our Lord's resurrection, I had a talk with a good friend, and we were talking about faith, and you know, they brought up the idea of, you know, it's nice to have the faith and the power to be able to resist the temptations of the enemy. You know, the devil might try to throw temptations at us to lead us down a dark path and whatnot. But if we don't let the temptations lead us away from God and our relationship with him, what else can he do? You know, are there other things that he'll do to distract us? before reading Galatians 5, verses 5 to 6, I just want to ponder on what will God do, what will the enemy, the devil, do if he can't tempt you into wrongdoing, if he can't tempt me into stepping outside of God's truth and his word for us? What can he do to take away our time from God and our connection with God and our relationship with God? Don't forget those other five things at the bottom of your checklist, friends. It's got to be done before tomorrow, right? And better get done quick, right, Park? Quick, right? The hustle and the hurry. And he can just get us busy. If he can throw things into our lives and try to influence our lives so that we just get busier and busier. And I got to hustle and hurry. And oh, yeah, so-and-so needs this done. I'll bet they need it done, too. And they needed it done quick. All of a sudden, that time that I was prioritizing to spend with my Heavenly Father and building and growing my relationship with him, has that time lessened and weakened and drawn back? I've just got to get these things done real quick, God, and then we'll spend time together. Or have I prioritized God and made him first and foremost and said, all right, checklist. All right, cell phone, life, you're on pause for a while because it's time for me to spend time with my Heavenly Father. And not allowing the busyness that the world can produce into our lives to negatively influence my relationship with my Heavenly Father. One more fun, quick bunny around the tree thought here real quick. But another one of the fun posts that I saw and read talked about there was this horse that was leaning back and, you know, kind of fighting and whatnot and acting like he didn't want to be tied up to this post. And the young cowboy was out there and the enemy was trying to tempt the young cowboy and says, hey, why don't you just let that horse go out there and graze on that grass just a little bit? He just wants a little grass. It's okay. Just go untie that horse real quick. It'll be all right. So the cowboy was the young horse person was tired of messing with this horse that was pulling back so much. So he went over, followed that thought of untie the horse, let it go graze on some fresh green grass, and it'll calm down, right? Till the horse on the fresh green grass jumps into the neighbor's yard, trashes the neighbor's garden, and then tears up a bunch of the neighbor's stuff. The neighbor gets mad, furious, you know, he takes his, gonna go solve this loose horse problem because the person isn't coming over to take care of their horse, so he solves it. Well, then the horse person's kind of mad for his horse getting shot. He goes over to his neighbor and in a confrontation with him. So all of a sudden, the horse person's in front of the judge and that guy over there told me I should untie the horse. And he caused it. The devil caused it all. And the devil's just sitting there. All I did was suggest to untie the horse. I didn't cause any one of them to pull the trigger. I just lied with a simple suggestion to untie the horse. So am I carefully listening to the thoughts that are coming into my head so that I'm not allowing a deceiving lie to lead me down a path that might not be healthy? And follow it. And what is my litmus test to tell, is it truth and will it work? And is this thought from God? How does it align with his written word and the truths that he has shown me in his written word? In Titus 3, verses 4 to 7, we are encouraged. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. So we have the hope of eternal life, friends. And not based on any good things. Do we do good things? Yes, it's good to do good things. To share God's love and pass God's love on to other people so that they can know the joy in the journey of life. But those good things aren't to earn something. It's as a result of something. And the blessings that we can have serving others in love and helping them learn how to love themselves, you know, just that works for our kids. Helping the young people in our lives, all of them, learn how to love themselves so that they can pass that love on. And our children can be in an apprenticeship program, so to say, for learning how to be the best adult they can be by watching the adults, the healthy living adults around them. So I hope I'm being a healthy living adult for all of the young eyes around me, young physically, young in every way, shape, and form. And I hope that each of you can charge forward enjoying being a positive, uplifting light of love for all those around you. So as we're going forward this week, charging into March, being lights and examples of his love, we have the Larson family that we'll keep lifted up for prayer and provision for restoration from seizures, as well as provision through that process. And also, we'll give God thanks and praise for Summer Buston's receiving recovery and restoration from the surgery she had. She's doing better, but we can keep her lifted up in prayer. So that's a good praise. Do we have any other prayer requests we'd like to take to our Heavenly Father this morning?
All of those that have come down with this flu that's going around, it's a real nasty bug. It's causing a lot of discomfort for a lot of people.
Yes, everyone dealing with this, the flu bug going around, and all those having to deal with the health care for everyone dealing with the flu bug. So I will try to remember to drink lots of water to keep the system flushed out and stay as healthy as we possibly can. Yes, amen.
We have that opportunity all the time. The second thing I wanted to say is if you could all please remember our school district in prayer for guidance and wisdom. That's the shortest explanation I am comfortable giving, but there's decisions to be made, and I think that the Lord's hand should be coveted in this situation.
Amen. Yes, keeping the school system, Bennett County school system, lifted up in prayer for wisdom and guidance from God, and that they would seek God fully, that all of the leadership in the school boards and the meetings could seek God's will and wisdom for the decisions that they need to make for what's going on and anything that's happened.
Surgery
on April 12th.
Yep.
Okay. Yes, we'll continue to keep Dixie lifted up and all of Dixie's family. And all of her caretakers. There. I was blessed with the opportunity to get to stop and see her the other day while we were in Rapid, and it was good to see her and be able to shake her hand, and she's coherent and able to talk and communicate and stuff, so that was a blessing. Good to be able to pray with an old friend. Okay. Bertha Johnson and Steve's aunt. So Bertha Johnson family and Tony Martin family. Awesome. Let's lift up these prayer requests and praises to our Heavenly Father in faith this morning. Father God, we just thank you that we can come to you and lift up praises and give you thanks and praise for the restoration and recovery that Summer is receiving and has received with the surgery. We also give you thanks and praise for the restoration and recovery for Michelle Vanderbay, and we just ask for continued abundant provision for both of them and their families through this time of healing, their bodies coming back into full use and enjoyment and functionality for them. And Father, we also give you the thanks and praise for getting to see Hope up there, as well as getting to see Dixie each opportunity that we get to see them. And Father, I ask that your peace and your comfort and your guidance would continue to surround Dixie's heart and mind, and that your wisdom and guidance would follow all of her family, and your peace would follow all of her family, as well as all of her caretakers up there through this time. And we pray the same for Hope while she is up there, that all of her family and all the caretakers would have your wisdom and your peace and your hope and your guidance for them. And Father, we'd like to lift up, just ask for your hand of positive, productive influence for the Larson family, and the wisdom and guidance for the medical teams helping their child with the seizures, and that they would have provision through the time with seizures and after the time of seizures is over and solved. May your provision and your hand of grace and provision be over their family, Father. And we would like to lift up everyone who's and ask for wellness and health, for everyone who's gotten the contagious flu bug, and just health and wellness for all of us who live around this disease, that we could remain healthy and well, and that everyone who's taking care of someone with the contagious flu bug would have wisdom and guidance and good health, and bring forward restoration for all those in our community that are battling that bug, Father. We thank you that you are the God who forgives all our sins and heals all of our diseases. We just claim that promise. We would ask for comfort and peace through their time of grief, for the Bertha Johnson and Tony Martin family, and that they would be able to celebrate the lives of their loved ones as they go through the time of grief and healing from that process, in that time. We lift up Jacko and just ask for peace and comfort and strength for him as he prepares for the surgery on the 12th, April 12th, and that surgery provides the solutions for any health issues that it's been causing, Father. We would also like to lift up Bob and Missy Barkley and ask for peace and provision for the mission work that they do in Paraguay. We lift up all of our medical personnel, Father, our military, our first responders, and ask for safety, wisdom, and guidance for them, and peace for them as they provide their services. We lift up all of the school people, the teachers and the kids especially, as well as the managers of the district and the people in charge of helping our children learn. We would ask for wisdom and guidance for each one of them, and for peace and joy and love for the kids, that they can enjoy the process of learning, and that the teachers can enjoy the process of sharing knowledge with the students, Father. We ask for your hand to be on our school systems, and for everyone in the school, from children to the superintendent to the school board, to all actively seek you and seek your wisdom and guidance in their lives and in the way that they do their learning. And finally, Father, we lift up the nation of Israel and all of the Israelites worldwide and ask for your safety, wisdom, peace, and guidance and comfort for each one of them, Father. We lift up all these things with faith in Jesus' name, with the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace, friends. Grace and peace, and let's enjoy a great, joyful, loved week. Cheerio.